واصحابه اجمعين. اللهم افتح علينا حكمتك وانشر علينا رحمتك يا ذا الجلال والاكرام برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين. Sallallahu alayka ya Rasulallah, sallam alayka ya Habiballah. Dear brothers, it was quite some time ago, probably a year or more, that a questioner asked a question about Khilafah. Well, we had to go by turn, in turn. You know, there are a number of questions about different topics. So he asked on the email, he asked the concept of Khilafah, the practicality of Khilafah in the present times, and that whether it is an obligation of the Muslim Ummah to establish Khilafah. Also he questioned how it would be possible to establish if it is obligatory, if it's essential to establish it in the 21st century. The questioner, in his email info, also stated, I don't have email myself, but the emails come to our colleague and he gives the printout to me. I'm not familiar with email or internet or anything like that. The questioner also stated that there are a lot of advocates of Khilafah who plead for Khilafah. They confuse the people about this matter by forwarding their versions on Khilafah. This is the question put to me on email. I asked the questioner, at all present here, well, in the class on that day, not today, I asked them to, the questioner, hopefully he was also sitting among the, you know, among all others, because when I received the email, I don't really know who the questioner is, nor I need to ask. I'm more concerned with the matter at issue, not with the person who puts the matter, puts the question. So I asked all present, among them, hopefully, there was the questioner as well, to elaborate the arguments put forth by the contenders. But in this question, he only said that some people put forth their own versions and they confused the people about Khilafah. So I asked in the class to all present, then, please elaborate. What are their evidences? What are their arguments that they put forth, those who were the contenders of Khilafah, in support of their contention? So that I should look into the matter from that angle and deal with this question in response to their argumentations. In his info, as per my asking, the questioner or somebody from among the people in the present then, they elaborated the question, they only elaborated the question and added that the group like Hizb ut-Tahrir and Muhajirun contend, that's what they wrote in the question. Hizb ut-Tahrir and Muhajirun contend that there ought to be one Khilafah for the entire Muslim world, who should administer the affairs of the Ummah and implement the commands of Sharia. Since these groups reject the present day democratic system of electing the members of parliament and the heads of government. So this was in response to my questioning. He only added that such and such group advocate and they are against the present system of democracy of electing the members of parliament and heads of government. So in fact, what he stated in response to my request for elaboration of the question was already known to me. And he did not state the arguments and evidences forwarded by the advocates of Khilafah to support the statement. That's what he wanted to know. What are their arguments? But they did not put forth any arguments advanced by them. They did mention, again, even though I asked them, what are their arguments? They didn't mention the argumentation to me. Nonetheless, inshallah, I shall take up the articles of this question one by one and try to answer within the best of my capacity and capability of understanding with the tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the mercy of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and with the benign attention of Sayyidina Ghawsul Azam and my Shaykh Sayyidi Ziaul Ummat Peer Muhammad Karim Shah alayhim ar-Rahma. I heartily feel obliged to offer heartfelt thanks to all the learned scholars, all of them, who were my guides, my mentors, regarding this issue, especially Allama Ghulam Rasool Saidi, Dam Barakat Maul Aliya, the compiler of Sharah Sahih Muslim in 7 volumes and Tafsir Tibyan al-Quran in 12 volumes. I pay special thanks to him because of his convincing research, wherein he left no margin of doubt, collected in Sharah Sahih Muslim Volume 5, which has been of great help to me in this regard. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him long life and shower his blessings on him. He is alive and he is still doing service to the Ummah, living in Karachi. May Allah ta'ala give him long life and enable him to continue with his useful and valuable contribution for the good of this Ummah. So as I said, inshallah, we shall take up this topic because it's not a, you know, here, it's not a lecture like that in 1 hour and 1.5 hour we shall deal with all the issues regarding this matter because we're doing dars type, lesson type talks. So, inshallah, we'll deal with them one by one. Obviously, not in one session. Not even in two sessions. More than that. So, I don't think any one of you would expect me to deal with all the issues and all the matters from all angles on this topic in one talk. It will take me quite a number of sessions, inshallah. So, what we're going to cover in it, inshallah, I can let you know so that you should not preempt with the questionings, you know. You know what I mean? Preempt means already ask the question which I'm going to deal with later on, perhaps in the next section or in the section after. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Let's see how does that write. Yes, better. That's the Islamic day, third date, third of the third month. It is third month, it's Rabiul Awwal. Muharram, Safar, Rabiul Awwal. Third of the third month, 1437. And I think English is this one. Correct me if I'm wrong, please. Wherever. With the spelling, with the date. So what we're going to cover in this is literal meanings of Khilafah. What does literally mean? What is the meaning of the word Khilafah or Khalifa or Khilafah? Concept of Khilafah. What is, you know, what form it has? What is the form of Khilafah?
Khilafah.
the prerequisites for Khalifa. The Khilafah is a system, and Khalifa is one who is the, you know, is the elected in that system, Khalifa. Wherein we shall include the criteria for the election of the Khalifa. The criteria for the electors. Is everybody eligible to vote? Who the Khalifa should be? So we need to know the criteria for electors as well, Islamically. That's a very long word, establishment. The establishment of Khilafah. I'll have to sit down now. No, not quite.
So we can put your chair there.
No, all right. I won't be here for long. Rising against the Hakim, the ruler, yes, taking up arms, let us throw them away and bring our own system here, like some groups are doing. Western democracy compared with Islamic standard of rule or government, and finally we shall conclude and end with the summary. What we would have learned in all these topics. Is there any interest in it, in these topics, among any one of you? Interesting, are they?
Yeah, very. It's quite comprehensive.
Mashallah. That's why I said I'd tell you what, you know, what I'm going to cover in my talk, in these sessions that we're going to start tonight, inshallah. When I pause for a while, I see there are some people writing it, so I let them finish their writing so that they can pay attention to what I'm going to say. It's all right, they can wait for a second or a minute or something. Literal meanings. We'll start with the literal meanings. Lexicological meanings. The dictionary meanings. Literally, Khilafa is derived from the radical. Radical means, I know some of you know better English than me, but some of, there may be some one or two who don't know the exact meaning of certain words, so I make it easy for everybody. Radical means the root word. or the root letter. It is derived from the root khalafa yakhlufu khalifatan. You know, the Arabic words have mainly, except the abstract noun, they have the root words. They all derived from their roots. Khalafa yakhlufu khalifa. So what it means, the root word means khalafa yakhlufu, to appoint a deputy to exercise the delegated powers. That is al-munjid. This is the definition in al-munjid, al-munjid Arabic dictionary. To appoint a vicegerent, a deputy, to exercise the delegate powers, not his own powers. So if one appoints somebody as his deputy, then he can only exercise the powers delegated to him by the authority who appointed him on that place, on that stage, or on that status. So that's what khalifa means. That's what the meaning of khalafa yakhlufu. To appoint, the meaning of the root word is to appoint a deputy to exercise the delegate powers. The renowned, that was from al-Munjid. And another great lexicologist, Imam Raghib Isfahani, great color, is a very authority, you know, among the lexicologists. Lexicologist means those who know the roots and origin of the words. Lexicologists. Allama Raghib Isfahani writes about khilafa. What does khilafa mean? So that was the meaning of the root word, khalafa yakhlufu, where the word khilafa is derived. To appoint a deputy, to exercise the delegated powers. So, act of appointing a deputy is called khilafa. Yes? Act of appointing a deputy to exercise the delegated powers is called khilafa. So what is the definition of khilafa? Nir Allama Raghib Isfahani. In Arabic, he writes, Al-khilafatu an-niyabatu anil-ghairi imma li-ghaibat al-manubi al-anhu imma li-mautihi wa imma li-ijzihi wa imma li-tashreef al-mustakhlaf wa ala hadha al-wajh al-akhir astakhlaf Allahu awliya'ahu fil-ard. This is the definition of khilafa forwarded by Allama Raghib Isfahani, the great, renowned, acclaimed lexicologist. Translation. Al-khilafatu an-niyabatun anil-ghair. Khilafa means to be the deputy of an authority other than him. So you cannot be deputy of your own. You must be, the khalifa is the deputy of someone else, other than his own self. So khilafa means to be the deputy of an authority other than his own self. Imma li-ghaibat al-manubi anhu. Then he says there are four causes of khilafa. Why a deputy is appointed? Why? What is the cause of appointing a deputy? When a person himself is authority, or when a being, doesn't have to be a person, even Allah Ta'ala is an authority, and he appoints the khalifa. So if a being, if an entity, you can use the word entity, if an entity himself is an authority, why does he have to appoint a deputy? So there are four causes, he says, for appointing, only four, no more than four. Imma li-ghaibat al-manubi anhu, either in the absence of the authority, who appointed him to exercise the delegated powers. So that authority is absent. So he appoints someone else as his deputy to exercise the delegated powers in his absence. That's one cause. Either in the absence of the authority to exercise the delegated power unto him. That's one cause. Imma li mawtihi. Or because of his death. The actual authority is not present. He's died. He left this world. So a deputy is appointed. Imma li ijzihi. Third cause. Because of his incapacity, inability. He's so infirm, so weak, or so ill, or whatever the cause, that he is unable to carry out his duty, his job. That is the third reason, because of the incapacity of the authority. And the fourth, to honor him by delegating a power to him, for the sake of honoring the Khalifa, only for the sake of honor. The authority himself is alive, is present, is capable of doing everything, but just he honors someone for the sake of honoring him, only to give him respect, to give him an honor. That is the fourth cause for which one of the, you know, either these are the four causes, or only for which a deputy is appointed. And then he says, Lisanul Arab, the lexicologist, Wala hadal bajil akhir, it is because of this last cause to honor someone, to appoint a deputy just for the sake of his honor. It is because of this last cause that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made his favorites as khalifas on this earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obviously he's since ever, forever, he's ever alive, live. So he's never absent. It is because of the fourth cause to honor the deputy, to honor the being, and honor an entity. He has appointed his favorites as, and his prophets are his favorites, the awliya Allah, his friends are his favorites. That's why he has appointed them as khalifas. It is because of this final, this last cause. To make it more simple, literally, a khalifa is he, I make it more simple for you now, a khalifa is who is appointed and empowered to exercise his administrative authority on behalf of someone else because of his absence or his death or his incapacity or to honor him in the sight of others. This is why a khalifa is appointed. And the nearest equivalent for khalifa in English in my sight is vicegerent. I use the word deputy, but vicegerent is the more nearest equivalent for khalifa. Vicegerent, V-I-C-E-G-E-R-E-N-T, I believe.
Viceroy.
I don't know, maybe wrong. I know the human authorities, when they appoint somebody, they call them viceroys. But whether when Allah Ta'ala appoints, will you still call him viceroy? That's a question, isn't it? That's why I wasn't sure. That's why I used the word vicegerent. You may be right.
No, I understand your point.
Yeah, you may be right, but I thought a viceroy is only when a human authority appoints someone as his or her deputy. They are their viceroys. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appoints, I haven't read anywhere the word viceroy for the prophets. They are the vicegerents of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why I used the word vicegerent. Allah Ta'ala knows best. This is an English word anyway. The Arabic word is Khalifa. So this is the literal meaning of Khalifa or Khilafa. Yes? Are we clear about the literal meaning? Or is there any doubt about the literal meaning? Lexicological meanings. Before we move on to the concept of Khilafa. Now, technically speaking, that was little meanings. You know, there are some words which have the literal meanings, whereas they have the technical meanings as well. For instance, I give you the example. The word hadith, something that new has come up from the tongue of someone or from the action of someone, that's called hadith. That's a literal meaning. But the technical meaning is the words of the Noble Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the action of the acts of the Noble Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the approvals of the Noble Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is hadith. So one side is the literal meaning, the other side is the technical meaning. Now we know the literal meanings of Khalifa or Khilafa. Technically speaking, the Khalifa is he who is chosen and appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the technical meaning of Khalifa. Who is appointed and chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and exercises his delegated powers in all affairs, whether religious or administrative, in obedience to the command of the supreme lawgiver Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So technically a khalifa is he who's chosen and appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he exercises the powers delegated to him by Allah ta'ala in all affairs, whether they are the religious matters or the matters of administration, but in all cases in obedience to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence, he is called Khalifatullah fil ard. That's why he is called Khalifatullah fil ard. The Khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. Referred to chapter 2, verse 30. A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 30. A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim. Wa iz qala rabbuka lil malaikati inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. Yeah. Remember, or recall, O my Prophet, because the Noble Quran is addressed to the Noble Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, addressing the Noble Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wherein he has addressed his beloved Prophet. O my Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, recall when your Rabb said to the angels, I'm going to appoint a Khalifa in the earth. I'm going to appoint a vicegerent in the earth. All the prophets are the khalifas of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Adam alayhi salam being the first khalifa, and the seal of the prophets, the last of all the prophets, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He is the final as well as supreme Khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allama Sayyid Mahmood Alusi Baghdadi Hanafi, he is from Baghdad, he is Sayyid, and he is Hanafi as well from Baghdad Sharif. In his tafsir Ruhul Ma'ani, Allama Sayyid Mahmood Alusi Baghdadi Hanafi writes in his tafsir Ruhul Ma'ani, فَهُوَ صَلَّ اللَّهُ وَالْتَعَالَىٰ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ عَلَى الْحَقِيقَةِ خَلِيفَةُ الْعَظَمِ لَوْ لَهُ مَا خَلَقَ آدَمْ. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in reality is the supreme Khalifa, Khalifatul Azam. Allama Alusi writes, he is the supreme Khalifa, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and had it not been for him, Adam alayhi salam would not have been created. Since there is no prophet to come after the seal of the prophets, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is the last prophet. No doubt we believe Isa alayhi salam will come near the end of the world. But he will come not as a prophet. He will retain the rank of status of prophet. The status of prophet once given is not taken back. Not at all. Allah Ta'ala chooses only those who are worthy of this office, of this status. And all the prophets who have been chosen as prophets, select by Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, their status remains as prophets all the time. But even Isa alayhi salam, when he comes to this world, he will come. He will still retain his status of prophet, but he will come as a follower of the noble prophet. So in that coming, he will be a follower, not as a prophet. For example, I always give the example and to explain. For example, if A is your imam of the mosque, for example, one day he says to someone else, please you lead the prayer for me. And he stands in the row. He's present. He stands in the row. Now that second person leads the prayer. Does he become the imam? For that namaz, he is the imam. Fair enough. What about the imam himself? Did he lose his status of imamate? He's still the imam. For that namaz, he is muqtadi. He is the follower. Otherwise, he has not lost the status of imamate. So Isa alayhi salam, when he comes, during that period, he will be the follower of the noble prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whereas his status of prophethood will still remain. He will not lose his prophethood. So he is the one to come, but he will not come as a prophet. No new prophet is going to come after the seal of the prophets. Anyone who claims to be the prophet after the noble prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a liar, is a kazzab, is a kafir, no doubt about it. So much so, the Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah ta'ala says that even if somebody asks him the evidence of his prophethood, only with a view to believing him, if he produces the evidence in the form of a miracle, he becomes kafir himself. Because he should have full certainty in his heart that there is not going to be any prophet. Why did you ask him the evidence? Okay, if he asks him the evidence with a view to defeating him, that's different. Like ulama have done it. But with a view to believing him, if he produces the evidence, that means your belief in fidelity of the noble prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is raw. Yeah, it's not complete. So he becomes kafir. So there's no prophet after the noble prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Since there is no prophet to come after the seal of the prophets sallallahu alaihi wasallam, therefore he who is appointed as his successor to administer the religious and administrative affairs and is empowered to exercise his authority in obedience to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam is the khalifa of the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The prophets are the khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Adam alayhi salam being the first khalifa, all the prophets were the khalifas of Allah ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam being the last and supreme khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now there's no more prophet to come. Anyone who is appointed as khalifa will be the khalifa of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Khalifa of the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because there's no more prophet to come. It is to this effect, so we know what khilafat is. It's not an easy job. As it is because of this that Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he was asked to appoint his son as Khalifa after him, leave your will, O Amirul Mu'mineen, when some of the companions said to him, O leader of the faithful, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, Amirul Mu'mineen, appoint somebody to take this place of Khilafa after you, because he was injured, he was attacked with a knife by someone, and it was obvious that he's not going to survive for long. And when questioned, he said, no, not my son. They said, Abdullah bin Umar, why not point your son? He said, not my son. Was that enough for me to be accountable for what I have done? I don't want to give this job to my son only. Only I am enough to carry this burden before the court of majestic court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they really were frightened to hold the office of Khilafah. Because you are answerable. That's why he said if a goat or a dog or you know some animal, some narration says a goat, some say a dog. If an animal is killed at the bank of Euphrates in Iraq, I sitting in a Medina, I shall be answerable for it. Because I'm the Khalifa. So it's not an easy job to be a Khalifa. So the people who shout Khilafat, Khilafat, they should know who the Khalifa should be. What kind of person you need to be a Khalifa. So now whoever becomes the Khalifa is the Khalifa of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is to this effect that Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, do not call me Khalifatullah. Call me Khalifatul Rasulullah. Don't say I'm Khalifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am Khalifa of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah Ta'ala knows best the hikmat in his words. But I understand. I cannot corroborate with the authority. All what I'm saying is from the authorities. But I cannot corroborate with the version of the authorities in this matter. But I understand that he did not want to connect himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly. Khalifatullah is direct connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khalifatul Rasulillah. Not Allah's Khalifa, Allah's Rasul's Khalifa. So between Allah and Khalifa, there is Rasul. So Abu Bakr Siddiq reaches the Rasul causes him to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was one of the hikmah that I understand. Secondly, I have written the point here somewhere. Yes. When I was studying at home, I thought another point. He did not want to use the same title for himself as that of the noble Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Khalifatullah, Khalifa of Allah. Abu Bakr is Khalifatullah. He did not want to use the same title. He did not think it was befitting for him. He was worthy of using the same title as Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's title is. So he did not. For example, when Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's noble soul departed from his sacred body, and Abu Bakr Siddiq became the Khalifa, Khalifa to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And you know when he delivered his sermon to the audience in the masjid, especially on Fridays, there was a pulpit called mimbar in Arabic. Mimbar is Arabic word, not member. Member is the English word. For somebody who's a member of parliament, member of committee, or member of something, that's M-E-M-B-E-R. This mimbar is the Arabic word, you can spell it M-I-N-B-I-B-E-R, mimbar. Mimbar in Arabic, pulpit. You know, the three-step stage where the scholar sits to deliver the sermon. This is the sunnah of the noble Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was prepared for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in year 8 of Hijrah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to sit on the top level, if you like. You know, top step, top level. 1, 2, and then 3. When delivering the sermon, Abu Bakr Siddiq sat on the one below. On the second one. He says, no, I'm not worthy of sitting on that level where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat. And when Umar Farooq became the Khalifa, he sat on the one below. The very first one, the lower one, the lowest one. Imagine what Hazrat Usman Ghani would have done. He sat on top again. When people questioned, why you sat on top? Abu Bakr did not, Umar did not. He says, yes. There was a possibility that people might think Abu Bakr is taking the place of the Prophet. Because there were new reports. Now, Umar sat one below because there was a possibility that people may think that Umar is taking the place of Abu Bakr. There's no place below that. So I've sat once again on top. Nobody can imagine that. Umar Usman can ever think of being equal to Umar or Abu Bakr, let alone the noble Prophet. That's why he sat on top. Because there's no possibility of causing any concern in the minds of the people that I am equaling myself with someone else. So he did not sit, Abu Bakr Siddiq did not sit on top. This was the etiquettes and the protocols of the court of the Noble Prophet in the sight of the companions. It so happened that Rasulullah once said to his uncle Abbas, Anta akbaru minni. Anta akbaru minni. You are akbar than me. Now the word akbar means the greater, comparative degree greater, superlative degree the greatest. So it can be used for both degrees. You know, there is positive degree, comparative degree. Perhaps we don't read a grammar over here. For example, good is the positive degree, better is the comparative degree, best is the superlative degree. Bad is positive degree, worse is the comparative degree, and worst is the superlative degree. Or beautiful, more beautiful, most beautiful, likewise. Akbar can be used for comparative degree, greater, bigger, higher, senior than someone else, or the greatest of all. Allahu Akbar. Allah is the greatest of all. Now, the word Akbar can be used for a senior person who is higher, is more in age. Can be used for that to mean that as well. And this is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant. He was senior in age. Yes, he was born before Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His uncle, Hazrat Abbas radiallahu anhu. So he said, "Anta akbar minni." But Hazrat Abbas didn't think it was proper for me to say I am akbar than Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This akbar means someone senior to someone else. He said, "La ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, walakin sin." La ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam alayhi wa sallam. No ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I am not akbar than you. I am not senior than you. Except that I am born before you. Except that I am born before you. But he didn't want to use the word akbar in comparison with the Noble Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So similarly, I believe that Abu Bakr Siddiq did not use the word khalifa for himself. Khalifatullah is used khalifa to Rasulullah. I am not khalifa Allah. Don't call me that. Call me Khalifa of the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it is this Khilafah, brothers, the Khilafah after the apparent worldly life of the Noble Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is in question and which is the topic of our discussion. Just a preliminary talk.
Can I brothers, ask a quick question?
Sorry?
Can I ask a quick question?
Yes, yes.
You know, would it be incorrect to define Khilafah or Khalifa rather as successor?
As
English, as a successor.
Well, the English word is successor.
Yeah, so couldn't you say a khalifa is a successor? So you'd be a successor of a previous leader, if you like. It's just, you know, when you use the word khilafa.
Vajjarant.
You know, Vajjarant is fine, that's a leader on this earth.
Yes.
You know, when you define khilafa of Allah, I can't see that connection. I can see Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu was a successor of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Yes.
And vice versa, successor. But to say the Prophet was a successor of Allah, I'm getting a bit lost with that one, because I always felt that khilafah.
That's why you didn't use the word successor.
Successful. So you couldn't really be a successor of God.
God, we can't.
So I'm getting stuck with the khilafah.
Can't be successor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One thing. Secondly, brother, it's the English word. You may think better than, you know, if you think that's the right word, but to my understanding, the English word successor, one who succeeds someone, sometimes his son is successor of his father. Yes? Whether he has the capability or ability to take his seat, yet he is the successor. But for a khalifa, one has to, there is a criteria for it. Yes? So all successors are not khalifas. There is a criteria for the Islamically technical speaking. I'm speaking from technical point of view. From literal point of view, yes. Okay, you can say the successor. But from the technical point of view, from Sharia point of view, for a Khalifa, he has to meet a certain criteria which we should include in our topic number 3. If he meets that criteria, then he becomes the Khalifa. Otherwise, not everybody. Every successor to a person.